All right. So good morning. This is our spotlight for the Business and Education Network Committee, and we are going to spotlight a topic instead of a particular business. We're going to spotlight safety in the workplace. It seems to be a common topic around businesses, and safety is needed in every industry. And so we have a couple representatives from industry today to kind of panel with us about this topic, and we'll encourage all of you to ask questions at the end too. And we can bring up topics that are outside of these two industries that we're going to talk to. With us today, we have Chief Corey Rux with the Griffin Fire Department, and we have Rick Means with the Washington Retail Association. And both of them can talk broadly about a number of careers in their professions. But we also know that there are probably 14 other career, you know, fields that we aren't going to touch on today specifically, but I think that the concepts are applicable in all industries. So welcome. Thank you for being here.
Thanks for having us.
Great. All right. So our first question really focuses around, what does safety look like in your industry? So when we think about, you know, in the business, and you know, people go, oh, you work in a business, you know, there's not, you know, dangerous work to be done, but there are safety aspects versus in the fire, you know, world and the emergency management world, there's, you know, obvious safety issues. So Rick, you know, just could you give us a really, you know, brief overview of what are the big focuses on safety in the retail world?
We have quite a diverse group, but safety for us falls under more of a general classification. We have to follow labor and industry guidelines for all of our members. There's a variety of opportunities within safety, of being a safety lead at an individual store to being a corporate overall safety person. There's other sides of it, often referred to as risk management as well. I learned safety impacts people's lives in and out of the workplace, and we're still seeing too many accidents that stem from lack of training or lack of experience or lack of focus. So the need for safety folks is abundant. Every business will have one a safety person in some capacity. There's also outside services like us who provide safety information to our members specific to them. So there's many pathways I think you can take within the safety realm.
Yeah, sounds like there's a lot of, in terms of job opportunities. When we talk about safety specifically, as a new employee, you talked about training. So what is it that you're looking for? Like, what are those things around safety that are important for you when you look at an employee? Like, what kinds of skills and traits are you looking for?
And this is to Rick?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just kind of digging into that training part that you talked about, their lack of training. So what are you having to train them on?
Well, we're back to the basics. I would refer to a product that we made called Safe Me, and there's an essentials packet where they need to learn how to use ladders. They need to learn how to lift. They need to know about fire extinguisher use. Even though they may not use it, they need to know how that tool works and understand it. So if there wasn't something that happened, they could use that correctly. First aid is a requirement that all of our members need to have some sort of basic first aid training. It takes a while for an ambulance or EMT to get to the store, but somebody's got to, you know, understand what to do right out of the gate. So for us, it's not like construction as much, or, you know, where it's heavy manufacturing. So it's a little more on the basic side, but if you were in those other industries, there's a lot more layers that would add on to that on the equipment that they're using and the tools that they're using. So
great. Thank you for just kind of clarifying that a little bit. Mm-hmm. So on the other end of the spectrum, Corey, we've got, you know, your industry. So what does safety mean in your realm?
My goodness, safety in the fire service is in everything that we do, and it's such a large topic. I think first and foremost, safety for us starts organizationally and making sure that organizations adopt safe practices through policies and procedures, making sure that we are in line with the standards that the state puts out. You know, I mentioned L&I, we go by OSHA as well, and we also have safety standards put out by the WACs. And so first and foremost, we need to make sure that the organization is organized and that we have these safety practices and that we champion those safety practices. How it looks in our industry, though, is I think it's very much a two-part layered thing. It's first and foremost an attitude. So when we look to bring people on, it's making sure that we reinforce a good positive attitude about safety and that we really train on it and it become a developed skill to have that situational awareness to make sure that regardless of what we're doing, we're making sure that we're doing it in a safe and effective way. You know, the fire service, it could be that, you know, we're donning personal protective equipment when we go on EMS calls. And in this new life that we're living with COVID, you know, we are the front lines when we respond out to these calls. So it's the discipline and the attitude to be able to put those gloves on every time, to put that N95 mask on and to put eye protection on before you go into any residence, whether they have COVID symptoms or not. That's one example of how safety impacts us every day, to making sure that we have the right uniforms when we come to work, that are fire resistive and that we have protective soles on our footwear, and that we are making sure that the space is cleaned. And, you know, there's so many nuances to the fire service, everything from emergency response to driver operator, to, you know, the workplace itself, it's a large topic. And so we manage that with making sure that we have a robust safety program. We have a safety officer within our organization. That's one of our lieutenants. He leads the safety aspect or the safety arm of our organization in making sure that our facilities are safe, that the needs are met for all of our employees, and that we have up-to-date practices.
So I think I heard a couple of really important things. It's number one about attitude. It's the mindset that you come in with. And so when you're looking at any situation, you're thinking safety first. And that statement, I think, isn't just because you're in the fire safety world. That goes back to Rick's point, is that it's no matter what you come to work, if you're a cashier or you're in food service or you're in retail sales, there's safety hazards or safety situations to be aware of at all times, whether there's a trip and fall hazard or there's clutter, you know, whatever it is can cause a safety concern. And so how people learn about those safety aspects is kind of important. And so, the next question is pretty, again, it's broad, but, you know, we've talked about how do we help applicants demonstrate their knowledge around safety in that industry during the hiring process. And so, whether you're a teenager looking to start your first job or get involved, or you're an experienced person or you know, starting to enter the workforce after high school, what are ways that an applicant can show you or demonstrate to you their understanding of that important skill of safety awareness and aspects that they bring to the table already? That you both talked about kind of training and continuing to talk about that, but knowing somebody brings something to the table is important. So what are you looking for, whether it be from the cover letter to the application to the resume to the interview? What are some ways that somebody could demonstrate that to you? Rick, do you want to take this one first?
You bet. One of the ways that we are seeing or asking younger people who typically join or start in retail at early on in life is to take, and I'm going to reflect back to the Safe Me product again, because that will print out a certificate that they can attach to their application or resume. If you're going into the construction trade, there's an OSHA 10-hour course that would really help the job applicant get a job in that industry. Showing that initiative is going to be a plus to the interviewer, the interviewee to get that job, because they're showing an attitude or of being safe. Also, if you put into volunteer stuff, maybe you were the lead for the safety committee, or if you were did some sort of outside project and you were the safety person, and note that on your resume or application, showing that you have some experience with that will also be a plus. It's a that extra effort, it really shows to the interviewer or potential employer that you have a safe mindset. It's that attitude is already developing, like Corey talked about, because you're starting earlier and you're advertising that as part of your application.
Great. That's a great example. Corey, have you got any additional things that maybe students or future applicants could do to demonstrate their focus or attitude around that?
I think upon the initial application of coming into the fire service, if it's someone that's doing it for the entry level with really no experience in the fire service, it's really hard to demonstrate. Outwardly, I think it falls back to what we've been talking about, and that's coming to an interview or an application process with a sense of an awareness of what's going on around you, environmental or in a situational awareness is kind of what we look for. And when we put people through the process of the application, whether it be the initial testing phase, the application submittal with the interest letter and the resume, we're able to see things like Rick was talking about, what does their background show us about what they've been exposed to. But realistically, we've got a program that we can bring somebody in that has absolutely zero experience, and we start from the foundational levels of safety and help develop those good safe practices, help hone that that situational awareness mindset and champion safety. So there really isn't any prerequisite coming into the fire service, but I guess what we look for to answer your question specifically is this person have life experience? Does this person have that awareness just of what's going on around them, or are they walking through life with blinders on? And certainly it doesn't preclude them from getting into the fire service. It just might take a little bit more coaching and encouraging to get that person to that point of being more safety oriented and safety minded.
Yeah, it sounds like both of you, if I summarize a little bit, is, you know, the more things that someone is involved with, if they've been involved in team projects, if they've been involved in activities in their community, they're going to be a part of an organization that is going to have to think about those things. When you put on an event, you're thinking about how to safely, move people through the event. And now again, with COVID, we've got, distancing and other aspects that we think about. PPE, you mentioned earlier, it's like, if they have knowledge of those industry topics, it's important for them to be able to share that in some way, again, to demonstrate their understanding of the job, but also the awareness that they have. So I think those are great examples for applicants to kind of consider as they move forward. And then I did pop up the website that Rick had mentioned, the Safe Me from Washington Retail Association, and that's free to everyone. Is that correct? Anybody can go on. It doesn't take a student or a teacher. Any individual can go in and go do that.
Yes, it's all free. We've even added a COVID course. It's now a year old, but at least it's there for meeting that requirement as well. So,
and all of your members look at that as maybe something to trigger them in their application process. If they see that Safe Me, is that something that you guys have been able to do with your members?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Kind of like a preferred interview type of thing.
We've advertised it a lot to our members. So when they see somebody with that certificate attached or badge, they know that where it's coming from, and it helps. Anyway.
And I also believe you have it in another language. Do you have it in Spanish?
Correct.
And what are all the areas that you offer that exam in? You have, retail, but you also have automotive and some other areas.
We just have the three right now. Essentials, which is kind of the basics, cover just the basics, where they need to really start. And then we did automotive, where it carries over into automotive items that you won't see on the other side. And you can mix and match and make your own. You can take ladders in one and eyewash stations or chemicals and make your own certificate. It will list the modules that you've taken. So
okay. Perfect.
Anyway.
Great. No, that's, thank you. I appreciate the detail. So the last thing is, and you kind of mentioned a little bit about it, but when we start working with students, you know, early as middle school, we try to get them involved in various activities to, you know, engage them in those work skill types of things, and safety is one of them. What types of experiences do you suggest someone start getting involved with that would help them develop these skills? So you kind of talked about that, you know, situational awareness, but just thinking from a student's perspective, what would be some things that they could do to start practicing these skills and be able to speak to them as they go out into the workforce?
One of my suggestions is to head up the, you know, volunteer to be the safety lead in your, maybe you got outside activities or whatever. Whatever you participate in, safety is going to be involved somewhere along the line. Be that person and start to understand it more with each activity that you do. You know, if you're not, you could be on the front side of safety, or you can be on even on the back side of safety. Maybe you want to do research or risk management, or maybe you're a data cruncher and you want to analyze data. There's ways you can get involved with safety in that aspect as well. So there's different paths, I guess, within it. If you're more forward facing and comfortable working with people, be on the front lines and be a teacher, an instructor, be that person that takes that charge of that, you know, we're going to do this for safety's sake. So getting an education in it, whatever is offered in the schools right now is great, but continue to grow it. And if it's a profession that you believe you would want to continue in, there's organizations you can join. The American Society of Safety Professionals, in fact, they also teach a graduate course at Central in Ellensburg, and a lot of people come out of that. You get safety certified, ASSP certification is highly sought after by companies. If you've got that certification, that's another real plus as you move on in your career.
Yeah, I think from a student's perspective, I'll take kind of more the informal approach here, is that I think that there are examples every day. We walk through life every day and there are safety concerns every day. I think my message to students would be open to what those safety concerns are. If you're in class and maybe you're in a shop class, there are a lot of safety practices that go in when doing shop. Be open to not only what those practices are, but attach the value of why you're doing what you're doing. If you're driving a vehicle, you know, making sure that you are doing safe practices, and why, what's the value there? You know, what are those statistics with car accidents and distracted driving, and really trying to put the message out to the students that every day, regardless of what we do, we're safety officers, right? And we have to not only protect ourselves, but the people we associate with. You know, I think that the students today with COVID, you know, they have a front and center example of safe practices, washing hands, putting on masks, making sure and keeping safe distances. The why, I think, is what we need to answer, so that way they have value when they go forward as they develop a safety mindset and get into the industry. They've already understand to be able to look through the practice and see the value of why they're doing it.
Right.
Perfect. Exactly. I love that. And I would say that, you know, but we'll open it up to the panel or to the audience too, to ask any questions that they have. But from an educational standpoint, we work as hard as we can to provide students those experiences. Safety is a part of all of our classes. It's an included curriculum in CTE programs. And as I think Rick mentioned at the beginning, whether it's the SafeMe certification program, OSHA 10, or just daily practices and being signed off on tools and equipment, I know SPSCC has, again, safety programs within all of their classes, you know, trying to give those kids the initial exposure, and also to walk away, you know, with a CPR card or a BLS card or some type of documentation that says that we have learned about this and that I'm fully aware. So those are some things that we do probably in the education system to help kids do that. But I think that situational awareness is a pretty important part. So I'm going to open it up. We have a few minutes here to see if there's anyone else in the audience has a question around safety in the workplace and how we can help prepare applicants to be ready for that. Anyone have anything to ask or share?
Oh, I'll start. Can you hear me, Teri?
Yes, can, Pat.
Okay, thank you. You know, retail, on the retail side, so this question is for Rick. I see, safety concerns every day on the news when we see retail operations robbed and there's violence.
Yes.
And crime going on. How is your association and your safety program responding to those kind of circumstances?
Back to the Safe Meat product in Essentials, we have a workplace violence module that talks about the five different types of things. Robbery would be number one coming at them. We also have additional information that we've acquired through National Retail Federation and other sources that would give our business owner the tips and suggestions on what to look for. The flash mob robbery thing that you've been happening a lot in the last fourth quarter of the year, last fall, you saw a lot of that, and it talked about what to look for. We can give you there's clues that you can start seeing in advance, and being aware of that before it happens to you will help make this situation safer for you, or give you tips on how to avoid it, or things that you can do to the glass. There's plastic membrane stuff that can be put on the glass to make it so it doesn't break as easy. Keeps your employees safe. So
it sounds like there's some organizational things, like Corey said, that the business can do to be proactive.
And we have
those things.
And we have those kind of tools available to the businesses so that they can prepare and understand it. We push out weekly safety tips to our members, plus it goes out to whoever's on our mailing list. Every week I've got some sort of a topic that I'm talking about to raise the awareness or to remind them to rethink this again,
I think it also goes back to that situational awareness that we just talked about. And so in that module that you have, that gives students or people who are taking that exam an opportunity to reflect on how they respond in those moments.
Yes.
So that they have, again, a safe environment. And I would say in the education system, we talk about safety in our workplace, as safety on our campuses, and what are their responses and how do they handle maybe a violent or a negative situation that's going on campus. So again, students are getting a little experience in thinking through those situations also. I'm gonna go to Brad and then Christina.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to say that, that I believe the Safe Me, and I can't remember if you just said it in your talk, but it has the workplace violence module certification piece to it. So at least Pat, I can address a little bit of that, at least the intro part to it, but that's a cool feature in it.
Yeah. It's something that can happen to them. So we want to make them aware of, here's the different things to look for. Corey may have more to add.
Pardon me, I'm sorry. What did you say?
Preparation, being ready to address the situation by having some knowledge in the back end and thinking about it. Oh, all right. So if he comes through this door, where am I going to go? Where am I going to push my employees? How am I going to address the situation? Give them the cash, give them the stuff. Your life is more valuable than.
Yeah, and with workplace violence, that's something that we do train on quite a bit, everything from active shooter scenarios to unsafe scenes. And, we work hand in hand with our law enforcement officers. And, if there's unsafe scenes, we won't go into the scene. We'll actually park several blocks away, have law enforcement go in and control the scene before we go in and start, whatever medical assessment we might need to do. But certainly there's inherent risk in that. But yeah, we do train on that. We have training modules that through our electronic platforms that we have to be certified in and make sure that that we understand those scenarios when they occur, that our responder safety is number one. And like you'd said, we back out, we withdraw from those scenes and not put ourselves in those situations. With active shooter, it's a little bit different. We take more of an offensive approach with law enforcement, and we'll go in and start triaging patients right away and pulling patients out. But by and large, yeah, it's a very difficult thing. And, you know, there is no situation that is just so specific that you can write a policy on it, because our environment is so dynamic, and we often find ourselves reacting and having to just employ the best safe practices that we have in very non-discretionary time, right? And so the more practiced and the more polished that we can have our responders as far as safety goes, the better off they're going to react.
I've heard the word over and over again: training, 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 practice, practice, practice. It allows you to respond to the moment.
It's a mindset, but it's also a skill. It's a skill that we constantly have to practice. And for us, it starts at the top with the organizational, making sure that we champion that message.
Great. Christina.
Corey, I know that you had in a previous role, had some youth programming around becoming firefighter EMT. Can you talk a little bit about the training programs that you kind of probably started to help instill some of those safety practices in those young individuals you worked with?
Absolutely. So I'm still teaching fire science with the Montesano School District. I have juniors and seniors, and I teach them every single day. In fact, I'm here today, but I have a substitute teacher right now teaching my class. So I have 20 students in total, and we're going through the foundational Firefighter One curriculum. With that, safety is the first topic of every chapter. We discuss safety as we get into every chapter. Every discussion starts with safe practices based on whatever that that topic is for the day. Funny you bring that up enough, though, because this week we've been talking about building construction. And building construction is all about safety when it comes to fire and how buildings react when exposed to fire, heat, degradation, the lack of integrity in that structure, when to withdraw from the building. But it's been fun with the students because we've been actually able to walk around and see new construction and point out how our buildings are constructed, how the fires will influence that structure, and why safety is so important before we ever put ourselves in that environment. What to look for, the signature of that fire and that building before we ever make decisions strategy based. And so we're really kind of incorporating the safety conversation on the front end of every topic or subject matter that we cover throughout every class. And I think that the students initially, they maybe feel like the safety is dry and it's hard to be able to get those messages across. But when I can show them videos of floor collapse, you know, unfortunately we just had 3 Baltimore firefighters killed because of collapse. And so when we're able to put it into context and give them the why, it makes a little bit more of a profound effect. But yeah, that program is a phenomenal example of being able to capture the audience of our youth and kind of get them on that track of thinking that way and prepare them for industry. And although we're using firefighting as the medium, really that safety mindset is transferable to any discipline going after high school.
Well, I couldn't have brought that to a close any better. Thank you for that, Corey. That really is what we're talking about today, is safety across all industries is important, and that our candidates hopefully are starting to build those skill sets and demonstrate that to their employers or future employers. So thank you for joining us today. And we will continue to provide opportunities for students to develop these skills for our workforce.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you very much.